Okay, so our next topic is the parasitism in plants. You know, we are studying the ecology, and under this particular topic, we are studying the concept and the dynamics of the community. Under this, we have studied many relationships which are shared by the biotic factors which are present in the ecosystem. Various organisms interact each other to create these particular type of the interaction types. For example, we have studied the competition, then commensalism, amensalism, mutualism. All these interactions we have already studied. Now we are going to see the parasitism, in which the one species gets benefited while the other have its loss. Okay, so plus minus type of the relationship is there in the parasitism, and this type of parasitism is also found in the plants as well. So we have to study this parasitism, which is the part of the community, which is the concept which is found in the community when all the plants and the animals live together. They were interacting differently, and after the interaction, they were having the such a type of phenomenon, such as the commensalism, mutualism, amensalism, and the competition, etc. Okay, and with and in this line, now we are going to study the parasitism. All right, and we will focus this study even with regard to the plants only. We are studying the ecology from the botany point of view. Okay, so consider this is your syllabus. We are dealing with the paper number 2 and the chapter number 5, that is ecology and the plant geography, and we are here at the concept and the dynamics of the community. Consider the first slide. See, the parasitism, it is may be regarded as a special form of symbiosis. As you know, whenever we say symbiosis, under the symbiosis, the species A and the species B is always interacting with each other. In general, this interaction is called as the symbiosis. So parasitism is also a type of the symbiosis, in which the predator or the parasite is much smaller than the prey, and it remains closely associated with it. That is, whatever the predator is there or whatever the parasite is there, parasite is quite a smaller in size when it compared with that of its host. Generally, the hosts are bigger in size, and whatever the parasite is there which feeds upon this host, these parasites are smaller in size. Okay, and this type of relationship, in which the one smaller parasite, it is feeding on the large host, this is a negative and the positive type of relationship, because here the parasite is getting benefited. Hence, the positive sign is for the parasite, and the host is get negatively affected, because whatever the nutrients he is creating for his cell, these nutrients will directly consume by the parasite, and hence it get negatively affected. And due to this, we have put the negative sign for the host plant. So it is a negative and the positive type of relationship, in which the parasite is getting benefited while the host is getting cost, or it will negatively affected in this particular relationship. Okay, but one thing is interesting here, the parasite is 99% in cases you will find it is a smaller when it compared with that of the large size of the host. Okay, now this, see, this parasitism is very harmful to the prey organism, and it is beneficial for the parasite. As we have discussed, this is a negative positive type of relationship, in which the parasite is getting benefited while the host is getting cost. Actually, this particular parasitism term, it is a Greek word, okay, and this literally means the one who eats on the at the table of the other. That is, the food of the another is taken by the organism which has not created that particular food. In general English, we say if the table is there and the food material is placed on this table, then the one who is not the part of that system is going to come on the table and starts to eat this particular food which not belongs to him, right? So in a very similar way, when any plant, through the process of photosynthesis, this particular plant is creating their own food material within its body, but then suddenly the parasite comes on this particular plant, and whatever the food material this particular plant is creating, this food material or the nutrients is consumed by this particular parasite. So parasite, on the one hand, is does not creating any type of food material, but whatever the food material which is created by the other plant and it starts to consume that food material. Hence we use the word parasitism to describe it, because they were eating at the table of the others. The food is not created by the parasite, but still it is consuming that particular food. Okay, so basically the negative positive type of relationship is there in the parasitism, and the parasite is generally smaller than its host, and the literal meaning of the parasitism is the one who eats at the table of the other. Okay, now see, the parasitic plants are differ from the plants such as the climbing vines, epiphytes, and the aerophytes. Now see, many times students will get confused that if one plant is present on the another plant, then it must be the parasitic plant. No, this is not the case. Okay, now consider this picture. This is the bigger branch of another plant, and on this branch, these particular plants are growing. that doesn't mean these particular plants are parasitic to this particular plant. No, this is not the case, because there are many types of the vines which take support of the plant to grow above and above the ground. Okay, that is, see, for example, the climbers. What climbers do? See, if there is a bigger tree, and this bigger tree is having the very strong stem. Okay, and now the climber is growing. Okay, like this, and it is taking the help of the stem to grow above. Now, in this case, this particular climber does not absorb the nutrients which are produced by these particular plants. Now, this climber is using these particular plants for only the support. Only the physical support is taken by these particular climb to climb itself above the ground. Okay, and there is no parasitism. It is just taking a help from the another plant, and this particular plant is not negatively affected in this process. So this is not a parasitism. On the other hand, we have the epiphytes, the plants which grow on the another plant. These plants are also not taking any advantage of that host plant, but they are simply taking the habitat on that plant, because they require the light for their normal growth and development, and they will get sufficient light when they were placed on the branch, right? If they were placed below on the ground, they will not get sufficient light, and hence they cannot be able to complete their life cycle. And that is why this epiphyte starts to grow on the large branches of the another plant. But this another plant will not get badly affected by in this particular process, because they were only taking the shelter or the habitat on this particular plant and not taking or not consuming any type of nutrients from the plant. So this is also not the parasitic type of relationship. Whether it's the vines, whether it's the epiphytes, whether it's the aerophytes, all they are just taking the help of a plant. They are not parasitizing on that particular plant. That particular plant is not the host plant, and these types of the plant do not acquire anything from inside of the plant, of the host plant. Okay, so here this is not the parasitism, but these are the different ways in which the plants take the help of the another plant to get survived. Okay, now through these plants are supported by the other plants, they are not the parasites, right? Because they use the plants simply as a structure on which they grow, rather than to direct source of the water or the nutrients. As we have discussed already, that these plants are only taking the shelter, only taking the help from the host plant, and they were not absorbing any type of water or any type of nutrient from the parent plant or from the host plant. Hence, they cannot come under the category of a parasitism. But what they are just the vines, they are just the epiphytes, they are just the aerophytes. Okay, so all these plants does not come under the parasitism, but they are the different concepts in the plant kingdom. Now see, some of the species parasitize on the roots of their host, whereas some feeds on the stem. Okay, mainly, see, for example, if we are talking about the parasitism, generally the two main parts of the host plant which got affected by the parasite are the stem, roots and the stems. Okay, see, consider the stem and the root part of the plant is generally occupied by the parasitism organism, the organism which shows the parasitism or which one acts as a parasite. Okay, so here the stem part and the root part is actually very famous, where this particular parasite got attached and starts to consume the nutrients from the plant. Consider in this particular picture, see, this is the stem of the host plant. Okay, this is the host plant. The bigger tree is there, and the whole solid stem is there, right? And now this is the parasitic plant, and this parasitic plant, as you can see, its haustorium is going inside into these plants. Okay, and when they go inside the plants, they start to acquiring the water and nutrients out of these plants, and they will start to use this water and nutrient for themselves. So this is a real type of parasitism in which the stem of the plant is got occupied by the parasite, and these are parasites creating the special structure which are called as the haustorium, and this is a haustorium inserted inside the plant, and from inside the plant, from its xylem and phloem, the water and the food material is got extracted out of the host plant, and it is directly transported to the parasite's body, and in this way parasite survives on this particular host plant. All right, so basically here you have to understand the haustorium itself may develop from the roots or from the stem. Okay, so root and the stem are the two parts of the parasitism showing species or the host plant where this particular interaction is taking place maximally. Okay, so you should carefully remember from the examination point of view which part of the plant is actually involved in the parasitism. Now see, for most parasitic species, only the haustorium is embedded inside the host, serving to feed the parasite located externally to the host. Okay, now see, understand this type of relationship. See, here in this particular picture you can understand this is the parasitic organism, but this parasitic organism is placed outside the body of the host. Okay, it is not completely present within the body of the host, but it is completely present outside the body study of host. But what he is inserting? He is inserting only the haustorium, and this haustorium will be responsible for extracting the water and the nutrients from the host cell. So the typical parasitic organism is present externally to the host, but due to the presence of the special structure like haustorium, it can penetrate into its xylem and phloem and can extract the water as well as the food material from its host. Okay, see here the structure haustorium plays a very very important role, and this due to this presence of this haustorium, the host plant the parasitic plant will remain outside the host plant, but just simply insert its haustorium to extract the all the nutrients from the host plant. Okay, so that is why this haustorium, this particular structure, is of a critical importance when we study the parasitism. All right, now consider, see, however, this haustorium of some species proliferates in such a way that all the vegetative growth occurs within the host plant, that is endophytically. That is, it will not always the ectophytic type of the relationship, but sometimes it is also the endophytic type of relationship, that where in such a cases when the haustorium is go inside the host plant, these they go to the such a extent that their all vegetative growth takes place inside the plant. Then in such a case, we say the parasitism is of an endophytic type of the parasitism. Because when we say about parasitism, there are basically two types of parasitism, the ectoparasitism and the endoparasitism. Ecto is when the organism or the parasite is present on the skin surface, and endophytic, it literally means the parasite is entering inside the body of the host. Okay. So here, if all the vegetative growth of the parasite is occurring within the host, inside the body of a host, then we say that it's an endophytic type of the relationship. Okay, and these parasites generally emerge only when there is only to the flowers. Okay, that is when there is a growth and development of the flower, these parasites came out of it as well. So inside the body of a plant, there are many type of the parasitism, parasitic plants which grow inside as well, and they were coming out of the plant when there is a production of the flowers. All right, now consider this. See, example that will include the members of the genus Rafflesia. As you know, Rafflesia is the genus which is showing the largest flower, and this Rafflesia genus plants are typical, very typical in showing the parasitic nature, which is because these are Rafflesia plant, they grows inside the tropical vines, which are called as the tetrastigma and the stem suckers, etc. Okay, so this is, you can in this particular picture you can see the tetrastigma plant, and this is the parasitic Rafflesia genus plant which grows on this particular plant. Okay, so this is the example we can put forward in the UPSC mains examination, because these types of the examples are very famous in the botany, and hence you can easily justify your answer how the parasitism occurs within the plant kingdom. Okay, so here the genus Rafflesia, it is growing on the plants of the genus called as the tetrastigma, in which this particular plants take all its nutrition and completes their life cycle. Okay, this is the Rafflesia and this is the tetrastigma plant, and this shows the parasitic type of the relationship. Now see, let us consider the what are different types of the parasites. Okay, now see, if the parasites are feeding exterior on the surface of the organism, these are called as external parasites or the ectoparasites. Okay, for example, if there is a tree trunk and the on the outside the parasite is present, okay, it is not going inside, it is not going completely inside, then we say this type of parasites are the ectoparasites, and those which present inside the skin or inside the bark of the plant, these are considered as the endoparasites. Okay, so depending upon where the parasites is located, depending upon that, we have the two types of the parasitism. The very first is the ectoparasites, which are present on the exterior surface, and second one are the endoparasites, which are present inside the body of a plant. Okay, now internal parasitism, this is generally marked as a much more extreme specialization than the external parasitism, as it involves the complex mechanism. As you know, when you study the external parasitism in relation with that of the internal parasitism, you will come to know the internal parasitism is quite much more complex, and it is showing the extreme specialization of a plant which is infecting the host plant, because these are particular plants shows the very special kind of mechanism to be lived inside the other plants, and hence it involves very complex mechanisms. So on the one hand, we have the simpler type of the external parasitism, but on the other hand, we have the very complex, extreme specialization showing type of parasitism, which is called as the internal parasitism. Okay, now see, all the parasitic plants are of angiospermic. Okay, when we consider the plant kingdom, the majority of the parasitic plant are coming from the angiospermic group. Okay, majority of the plants are the plants which are showing the parasitic nature. They belong to the angiosperms. See, some of the examples of the angiospermic plant families which shows the parasitism is the Balanophoraceae, then Arabidopsis, then Rafflesiaceae. We have considered the example of Rafflesiaceae, but the members which belongs to these are the three families, they were showing the parasitic nature. Okay, now consider here, all through one species of the gymnosperm is there which is also showing the parasitism. See, Parasitaxus usta, this particular species is showing the parasitism which belongs to the gymnosperm. Okay, so we say majority of the plants which are showing the parasitism, they belongs to the angiosperms, but there are some rare examples as well which belongs to the gymnosperm. The very rare example is of the Parasitaxus usta. This plant is known to be parasitic. It actually may be the mycoheterotroph, as it appears to involve the fungal symbiont. Okay, myco, we understand it has some relationship with the fungal. Okay, so this Parasitaxus usta, which is showing the parasitic nature, it also involves the fungal partner, and hence this particular relationship we may describe it as a mycoheterotroph. Okay, so here from this slide you should understand the majority of the plant species which are showing the parasitism, they belong to the angiosperms, but some of the species are there which belong to the gymnosperm, which shows the parasitism, and one example is the Parasitaxus usta. Okay, please remember it carefully. Now see, let us consider the very prime example which is given in the plant kingdom for the parasitism is the example of the Cuscuta plant. Okay, now see, the flowering plant which is called as the Cuscuta plant, it is actually an holoparasitase, right, and is a parasite, and it has lost the chlorophyll and it lives in the course of the evolution. Okay, now consider in this particular picture, whatever the yellow lining you are seeing, see how the threads are there, yellow threads are there, these yellow threads are the plants which is called as the Cuscuta plant. Okay, now in the course of evolution they have lose their all chlorophyll, and you know the significance of losing the chlorophyll. If some plant is losing the chlorophyll, that literally means this particular plant is not able to photosynthesize. That is, photosynthesis will not occur in the Cuscuta plant because it has lost all of its chlorophyll content, and chlorophyll pigment is the prime pigment in the process of photosynthesis. That literally means the photosynthesis is not going to occur in the Cuscuta plant. So if there is a no photosynthesis, there will not be any creation of the food material. Okay, so food will not be get created in the process of the photosynthesis, and this particular Cuscuta plant will not survive on its own. That literally means it has got converted into the heterotrophic mode of nutrition. It is no longer an autotrophic plant. Now, although it is a plant, but it is not the autotrophic, because in the autotrophic plant, the plant is able to photosynthesize and creates its own food. But this particular Cuscuta plant, it has undergone the change throughout the evolution to get converted into the heterotrophic plant from the autotrophic plant, because it has lose all of its chlorophyll pigments. Now it is unable to manufacture its own food. This particular dodler plant, its food from the host plant is grows. Okay, it will obtain all of its food on the plant on which it is growing. Okay, see, consider here in the background you will observe the many plants are present, and this Cuscuta plant is a parasitizing on these particular plants. It will extract all the nutrients from the nearby plant on which it is growing. So you can put forward this example in the UPSC mains as well, as the Cuscuta plant, it has lost its chlorophyll over a period of time throughout the evolution, and it is not able to photosynthesize anymore. So this is the example of a plant which is a heterotrophic in nature. Okay, because the heterotrophic nature is generally shown by the animal, but there are some of the plants which are the heterotrophic in nature. Example, the very famous example is the Cuscuta plant, and hence it depends on the other plant for its energy needs, for its nutrient purpose. Okay, now see, these Cuscuta produce the peg-like roots which are called as the haustoria. So the root part is producing the special structure which is called as the haustoria, and these haustoria will later penetrate into the host plant around which they are twinned. Okay, see how they got twinned around the host plant, and after the twinning, the roots will produce the haustorium, and these haustorium will literally penetrate into the host. And after the penetration, the connection will establish between the host plant and the parasitic plant. And this connection is generally established with that of the conducting tissue. And you know, the conducting tissues are the xylem and the phloem. Okay, xylem on the one hand is conducting the water, while the phloem on the other hand, they were conducting the food material. So these conducting tissues is occupied by these particular haustoria, which is produced by the Cuscuta plant, and these haustoria will extract the water plus the nutrients from that of the host plant. Okay, whatever the host plant is there, these Cuscuta plant is extracting all of its daily needs from that host plant, and hence this is the very famous example of a parasitism. Okay, see the they establish the connection with the conducting tissue of the host and effectively parasitize their host. So after the Rafflesia example, you can also remember the Cuscuta example, because these examples will be really justifying your answer in the mains. Okay, and that is why you have to carefully remember this, and you have to carefully write it down these as a notes in your notebook. Okay, now see, the parasitic plants, they were evolved from the non-parasitic plants and thus underwent the evolutionary transition from the autotrophy to heterotrophy. Now when we talk about the evolution, how this a particular parasitic plant is got created, now these a particular parasitic plants are got created from the non-parasitic plants. Okay, of course some of the environmental conditions are there which may be responsible for the creation of such a plant, but one thing is sure, that these are parasitic plants are created from the non-parasitic plants. That is, earlier they were non-parasitic plants, but later they become parasitic over a period of time due to their surrounding situations. Okay, through they have gone the evolutionary transition from the autotrophy to the heterotrophy. That is, from photosynthesizing to the non-photosynthesizing plants, they have got through this process and get itself converted into the heterotrophy. Earlier these plants were also autotrophic plants which can create their own food, but due to certain environmental situations, they have got converted from the autotrophy to the heterotrophy. But here one thing is sure, the parasitic plants is came from the non-parasitic plants. Okay, and they over a period of time the evolutionary transition has occurred, and the autotrophy is somehow got converted into the heterotrophy, as you can see in this picture as well, how the Cuscuta plant is growing on the another plant. Okay, this particular heterotrophy may be the partial or the complete. Okay, now there is a range of the parasitic plants, and these are parasitic plants may be the complete parasitic plants or the partial parasitic plants. That is, this particular heterotrophy may be partial or may be complete. It will all depend on which type of parasitic plants we are talking about. See, depending upon that, we have two types here. First is the hemiparasites, which has the least some ability to photosynthesize, right? You should carefully remember these terms. These will be the very important in your answer writing. See, the very first type is the hemiparasite, which literally means they were having the some least ability to photosynthesize. That is, they for example, they were having the 10% or the 20% photosynthesizing ability. They did not lose all of their chlorophyll molecule, but somehow they can create the food material inside their body as well, and they were also taking the food and the nutrition from the host as well. Then in such a case, we describe such a plants as a hemiparasites. Okay, now they primarily rely on their host for the water and the mineral nutrients. Okay, they were taking the water as well as mineral nutrients from the host, but at the same time they were possessing some least ability to photosynthesize. That is, some ability of photosynthesis is there, but they were from the host, they were also taking the water and the mineral nutrients. Then such a plants, we will classify them as a hemiparasites. On the other hand, we have the second type of plant, which is called as the holoparasites. Now holoparasites, on the other hand, they were non-photosynthetic and depend on their host for all the nutrition. That is, these type of plants where can't done the photosynthesis even at the smaller scale, even at the least. Just like the hemiparasites are the plants which are showing the least amount of the photosynthesis. But here, exactly opposite, the holoparasite, these holoparasites are completely non-photosynthetic plant. And you know, the Cuscuta is the example of the holoparasite. These holoparasites do not have any ability to photosynthesize, and they were completely dependent on the host for their all type of the nutrition. While on the other hand, hemiparasite can manage their some amount of food material through the photosynthesis, and only the water and the mineral nutrients are taken from the host. But on the other hand, the holoparasite is the second type of parasitic plants, which are completely non-photosynthetic, and they were completely dependent on their host for their nutrition purpose. Okay, now see, these parasitic plants were also differ with regard to whether they were need the host in order to complete their life cycle. See, depending upon whether the parasite requires the host to complete their life cycle or not, depending upon that, again we have the two types of the parasites, right? The very first is the obligate type of parasite, which require their host absolutely to complete their life cycle. If the parasitic plant requires the host plant to complete their life cycle, then we say such a type of parasites are called as the obligate type of parasite. Then in the second type, we have the facultative type of parasites, in which they live and reproduce in absence of host as well. That is, they were taking some amount of the nutrition from the host, but their sexual reproduction is independent of their host. So in that case, we use the term facultative parasites. And if the parasite is completely dependent on the host for their reproduction and all of their life cycle, then we use the term obligate parasite. So here, the two terms are there, obligate parasite and the facultative parasite. The obligate parasites are those parasites which require their host to complete their life cycle, while on the other hand, the facultative parasites are those parasites which do not require their host to complete their life cycle. They can independently reproduce of their host. Okay, so these two types of the parasitic plants, you have to also remember it. Okay, so in this particular video lecture, we have understood what do you mean by the parasitism, right? We have taken the examples of the parasitism, then we have studied the types of the parasitism, then we have studied what are the special structure like hostorium which is able parasitic plant to feed on the host plant, right? Now whatever the molecular mechanism is there regarding the plant parasitism, we will discuss this in the separate video lecture. All right. So this is all about this topic. Okay, thank you very much for watching this video. Please like this video, share this video with your friends who are studying the botany, and if you haven't subscribed to the Botany Obsession channel yet, please subscribe to the Botany Obsession channel for UPSC examination. Again, thank you very much for giving your time. See you in the next video lecture. Thank you.